Hello, and welcome to the Migraine Diaries, a week-by-week account of the making of my game Scotoma and my certain and eventual doom at the hands of technology. Now, this episode, I'm going to dig a little bit deeper into the influences of the game. So here we go. The type of video game and film horror that I like tends to have a few hallmarks. They're often psychological in nature, as opposed to a purely physical manifestation, like slasher films, for example. It Follows is a great example of this on the film side. They also tend to excel in conjuring up a low-level sense of constant dread, only to escalate into chaos and mania. Safe Haven from the anthology VHS 2 is fantastic for this. This house has people in it. On the video game side, Silent Hill 2 and Among the Sleep. And finally, they tend to feature the warping of the human body. Videodrome and Hellraiser are obvious entrants in that category. At some point, I'll do a video on my sort of triumvirate of horror, horror films and horror games, which I'm sure will surprise none of you. Now, I've already mentioned Aphex Twin with Chris Cunningham and Silent Hill's Masahiro Ito as key influences on the visual and sonic feel of the game, and you can see how they pretty much fit into the categories I mentioned just now, but I'll give you a couple of qualifiers as well. Aphex Twin's Come to Daddy video was a blast of grotesquery that hit me out of nowhere, because I ran across it at about 3 a.m. after a night out, when I flicked on MTV, and the whole thing was just inexplicable. At the time, despite being a fan of jungle, I'd never heard anything quite like it sonically, and the fact that Chris Cunningham had set the video in a very recognisable scenario for those in the UK struck me too. It's an amazing and nightmarish piece of work, and I never get tired of it. As an aside, I can't help but see Arca and Jesse Kander as their natural successors. They're fantastic. Google them. With Silent Hill, and specifically Silent Hill 2, I can recall very clearly being in the Woodside Apartments section of the game, about to go through a door and hearing this. And I couldn't imagine what would be making that sort of noise. And I stood there for nearly an hour not wanting to see what was on the other side. And the power of that moment to me is fascinating, that you're that immersed and that affected. Ditto with Pyramid Head standing motionless on the other side of some bars that separate one of the hallways, the mannequin being assaulted by Pyramid Head, and so on and so on. Just so many fantastic moments in that game. And there's also so many different memorable moments in games that I could talk about. From Silent Hill 4, the slow deterioration of its central hub room. Silent Hill 3 as well, the mirror room that fills up with blood. Fatal Frame, the slow, dread-filled approach of the first ghost you encounter. Amnesia, the Dark Descent, the first monster encounter, while you're kind of, by design, hiding from it in a closet. It's engineered so you can barely see it, which is, you know, one of the threads that runs through the encounters. Outlast has a great moment, even though it's not the sort of game that I'm really taking influence from, with the first night vision encounter with the main monster. That was fantastic and terrifying. Portal, forcing you to incinerate the companion cube and congratulating you on it, is kind of a nicely twisted bit of, you know, mind games. Bioshock, the tension of the first Big Daddy encounter before you work out that it mostly ignores you unless you attack it or the little sister. That was a great moment of trepidation. Earthbound, your final encounter with Gygus, which is a sudden and jarring sort of tonal shift from the main bulk of the adventure. It's really tripped out, really fantastic. And of course, there's so many films as well. I've mentioned a few of them already. But there's Society, which is a satire of greed and parasitism in the 1980s, that takes a left turn so hallucinatory I still haven't quite recovered. There's Ring, or Ringu, a Japanese horror from the early 2000s, which to me is kind of the last word in slow-building dread and a chilly atmosphere. There's Possession, which is a psychosexual car crash of a film with Isabella Ajani, I believe she's called. Videodrome, you know, body horror and surrealism par excellence. The list is just endless. And also, with me being the audio guy, as well as the other stuff, there's music, of course. I've looked to Coil, Throbbing Gristle, Ortega, The Knife, Amon Tobin, the truly excellent and abrasive Pharmacon. If you don't know her, you should check her out immediately. Wolf Eyes, Haxan Cloak, and for those that know me, the inimitable Death Grips. All of these musicians are fantastic at fashioning something unfamiliar out of the familiar, and that's exactly what I want to do. I want to base a lot of the sounds and soundtracks off the organic sounds you find in offices and with people as well. So there's so many possibilities there, and I can't wait to get to it once the designs, you know, in good shape. And although I'll probably go into it more fully in another diary, it's also worth mentioning a big bunch of artists I've discovered while considering concept work, but I'll use a clever scrolling list thing here. They all excel at exploring the limits of the human form. But the point is that I'm spoilt for choice here in terms of influences, and the challenge will be to make something that stands on its own two gnarled feet, and maybe might even join these games, films, artists and musicians as an influence on someone in the future. That's all I want, really. That would be great. So that's it for this one. Next week, the tools I'm using to make this nightmare reality. Cheers.